Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Shankar IAS Academy's newspaper analysis for the date 23rd August 2021. These are list of articles chosen for today's discussion. As you can see, these articles are picked from various sections of the syllabus. So let us start our discussion by discussing about an op-ed article. In this article, we'll be seeing about the non-communicable diseases. What are the impacts caused by the non-communicable diseases and why there was disruption in the services for the non-communicable diseases. Followed by that, we'll be seeing about a deadly algal bloom in the Muttukade estuary. After that, we'll be seeing about three important images. The first image is about a temple in the Jammu and Kashmir, and the second image will be about an historical monument, and the third image will be about the Nagarhole National Park. Now let us move on to the discussion. Now let us take up this op-ed article about non-communicable diseases. This article can be split into three parts. In the first part, the author talks about the seriousness of NCD, and the second part highlights the disruption in the services of these NCD. And further in the third part, the author gives some solution to tackle the burden of these non-communicable diseases. See, you may think because of its characteristics, it is not very important to know about non-communicable diseases. But the real picture is around 71% of all deaths worldwide occur due to non-communicable diseases. So it is very important to know about non-communicable diseases and how to contain these non-communicable diseases. It may be very helpful in your mains preparation. The syllabus covered by this op-ed article is highlighted below for your reference. First, let us know about non-communicable diseases in order to understand the article better. See, the non-communicable diseases are medical conditions or diseases that are not communicated by infectious agents. These are chronic diseases of long duration and are usually slow in progression. Generally, these diseases are the result of a combination of genetic, psychological, environmental, and behavioral factors. Know that cardiovascular diseases, cancers, chronic respiratory diseases, and diabetes are the major NCDs. And habits like physical inactivity, unhealthy diets, tobacco use and the harmful uses of alcohol are the main behavioral risk factors for NCDs. Now moving on to the editorial, as we already saw, around 71% of all deaths worldwide occur due to non-communicable diseases. And in fact, cardiovascular diseases like that of stroke, heart attack and coronary artery diseases are the top causes of global deaths. Especially among younger patients, 1 out of every 4 deaths occur due to these cardiovascular diseases. When you take India, there is a rapid progression of such diseases and also a high mortality rate. And premature loss of life due to NCD is also very high. Among Indians, the age group between 30 to 69 years are highly affected. So on that line, in order to address this growing burden, the government of India under the National Health Mission initiated an integrated program, which is titled as National Program for Prevention and Control of Cancer, Diabetes, Cardiovascular Diseases and Stroke. And this particular program focuses on health promotion and prevention. And it aims for the strengthening of infrastructure including human resources, early diagnosis, management and integration with the primary healthcare system. As you know, with the emergence of COVID, lockdowns and isolation have become a new normal. And these lockdowns and reduced physical interactions led to loneliness among people. And this in turn resulted in the mental health disorder like anxiety and depression. Most importantly, such situation increased the exposure of NCD risk factors. This is because during lockdowns, people are more likely to increase their consumption of alcohol and tobacco and adopt an unhealthy diet. Note that COVID-19 patients with pre-existing cardiovascular diseases are in a more intense or serious state when compared to others. Likewise, among the various NCDs, diabetes persons are found to be at an exponentially high risk of severe clinical outcomes when it comes to COVID-19. Moving on to the second part, as we know, with the rapid spread of COVID-19 pandemic, the focus of NCDs were severely disturbed. And not only that, even maternal healthcare services, immunization and health surveillance were also disrupted. So, according to a WHO survey, low-income countries were the most affected by this disruption. Now, let us see some reasons that have contributed for the disruption of these NCD services. See, firstly, the staffs working in the NCD sector were assigned to support patients with COVID-19, and this led to the postponement of public screening programs. Another main reason in this regard is the shortage of medicines, diagnostics and technologies. And the disruption was further enhanced when the countries moved into the stage of community transmission. Apart from this, cancellation of planned treatments, decreased availability of public transport and lack of staffs are also some of the common reasons in this regard. Now, coming to the last part, see, the author here has listed down some important solutions to tackle the growing NCDs. Now, let us see them one by one. First of all, India's NCD response plan should include tobacco cessation activities and rehabilitation. This is because tobacco consumption has been indisputably linked to hypertension, cardiovascular diseases and stroke. Secondly, as of now, the state and national health policy makers should draw up a roadmap which gives equal weightage to patients living with NCDs along with the COVID patients, and the existing network of NGOs can be utilized in this regard. Similarly, instead of broadcasting the same messages over and over again, innovative campaigns on maintaining a healthy lifestyle should be encouraged based on the screening for non-communicable diseases at the grassroots level itself. Further on that line, telemedicines can be encouraged and alternative like online platforms could be used for disseminating informations. And most importantly, proper access to essential NCD medicines and basic health technology should be made available in all primary healthcare facilities. Therefore, a multidisciplinary approach that includes a strong health workforce, infrastructure, supplies and a continued access and care for the vulnerable population should be encouraged in this regard. So, in this discussion, we saw about non-communicable diseases, why there was a disruption in the services for this non-communicable diseases, and how can we overcome these disruption of services. With these details in mind, now let us move on to the next part of our discussion. Now, look at this news article. This is about the algal bloom in Muttukadu estuary. In this part of discussion, we'll be knowing about algal blooms and eutrophication. The syllabus relevant to this article is highlighted here for your reference. As you can see from the picture, Muttukadu is a estuarine landscape situated along the northern coast of Chennai. This estuary has been witnessing algal blooms as a consequence of eutrophication. This is what the reports based on few studies implies. Let us understand this further. See, eutrophication is the natural aging of a lake by nutrient enrichment of its water. Think of a freshly farmed lake. In a young lake, the water is cold and clear and it supports little lives. With time, streams draining into the lake introduces nutrients such as nitrogen and phosphorus. These nutrients will encourage the growth of aquatic organisms in the lake. As the lake's fertility or the lake's nutrient increases, plants and animal life multiplies. And after a period of time, the organic remains or the dead fishes and animals and the plants begin to be deposited on the lake's bottom. So what happens next? Over the time, as silt and organic debris pile up, the lake grows shallower and warmer. With that, marshy plants take root in the shallows and begin to fill in the original lake basin. Eventually, the lake gives way to large masses of floating plants, finally converting the lake into a land. Remember that depending on climate, size of the lake and other factors, the natural aging of a lake may span thousands of years. See, this is all normal if it naturally happens. However, sometimes pollutants from man's activities like effluents from the industries and homes can radically accelerate the aging process. This phenomenon has been called cultural or accelerated eutrophication. See, during the past century, lakes in many parts of the earth have been severely eutrophied by sewage and agricultural and industrial waste. These waste have prime contaminants like nitrates and phosphates. So they act as a plant nutrient. They overstimulate the growth of algae. See, these algae depend on the dissolved oxygen. When the algal growth is exponential, their oxygen consumption is also exponential. So the dissolved oxygen vital to other aquatic life like fishes and all is dissolved. And the dissolved oxygen is depleted. So, fishes and other organisms might die due to lack of oxygen. At the same time, other pollutants flowing into a lake may poison whole population of fish. After the death of the fishes, the decomposing remains further deplete the water's dissolving oxygen content. In such a fashion, a lake can literally choke to death. This is what is called as accelerated eutrophication. Remember, we just saw about exponential growth of algae. See, that is what is called as algal blooms. And that is exactly what has been happened in the Muttukadu estuary as well. See, these blooms, beside causing eutrophication, it is also harmful at another level. They release something called hepatotoxin. Hepatotoxin is something that is harmful to the liver. And the article mentions that the hepatotoxin released here is microcystin. Apparently, this can prove harmful to fishes, humans, birds, and other aquatic organisms if it enters the food chain. So, this takes us to the question of way forward. See, the solution lies in preventing wastewater discharge into the water bodies. This will prevent nutrient accumulation and thereby slowing down the eutrophication process. Besides, close monitoring of the dissolved oxygen levels, pH levels, and chemical contents are important in lakes that have already witnessed discharge of industrial sewage waste. See, lakes are a vital part of our ecosystem. Preserving them is a way to achieve sustainable development. So, it is very important to preserve the lakes. So, in this discussion, we saw about eutrophication and what is accelerated eutrophication and the impacts caused by the eutrophication. With these points in mind, let us move on to the next discussion. Now let us take up this picture for our next discussion. See, it is a picture of a temple called Takht I Sulaiman. It is also called as Jagdishwara Temple, and this is a temple located on Sankaracharya Hills overlooking the Dal Lake in Srinagar. See, the temple of Jagdishwara rests on the solid rock. It consists of an octagonal stone basement which is 20 feet high. This supports a square building, and the terrace surrounding the temple is reached by a stone staircase. The ceiling is supported by four octagonal columns, and this is the basic architecture of the place. Now, let us look in brief about the Sankaracharya from the exam perspective. See, Sankara is also called as Adi Sankara. It is generally accepted that Sankara was born in Kaladi, which is not far away from today's Kochi, in 1788 AD. If we see his philosophical inclination, it was in favor of Advaita. Note that Advaita is a Sanskrit word that literally translates as not two or no second. So, Advaita is also called as non-dualism. At the heart of his philosophy of Advaita Vedanta is Tat Tvam Asi or Thou Art Tat. This is the famous phrase from the Chandogya Upanishad. Let us understand this. It simply perceives the self, that is the Atman, as the absolute reality. that is the Brahman or God. So the Brahman is the sole cause, creator and consumer of the universe. That is, the charismatic power that created the world is inseparable from Brahman. As you can see, he simply says everything is one, that is God. And see, Shankara is also famous for his theory of Maya. It propounds that world is an illusion, all actions and emotions including sorrow are just false impressions. Besides, change according to Shankara is an illusion. That is, nothing that did not exist earlier will come into existence. The change of outer form is visible to some eyes due to the operation of Maya. But truth remains the same. That is the outer arm of the Advaita principle. Besides these information, just remember that he is famous for another philosophy called the Tarak Brahma. So with these informations, let us move on to the next discussion. Now let us take up this image for our next discussion. See, the image depicts a historic monument called Gosha Mahal Baradari. It is a home of Free Mansions of Hyderabad and it is one of the most imposing palaces built by the Qutub Shahi Sultans. It served as a guest house of the Qutub Shahi state and stands as one of the most splendid civic monument of the glorious period. And it is still in existence in Hyderabad. So in this backdrop, let us know about the Qutub Shahi Sultans. See, Muhammad Quali Qutub Shah is the founder of the city of Hyderabad. In 1589, Muhammad Quali Qutub Shah founded the city of Hyderabad, which is south of Musi River and 8 kilometers away from the Golconda Fort. See, he built a bridge over the river to connect the fort to the city, and this bridge is now called as Purana Pal. See, let us first know about the history of the Hyderabad city to understand about the Qutub Shahi dynasty. See, after the end of Chalukya dynasty, the Kakatiya dynasty took over the area ruling from Warangal, which is 180 km from Hyderabad. Around 1320 AD, Muhammad bin Tughlaq invaded the Kakatiyas from Delhi, which resulted in the Bahmini Sultanate. Under the control of Bahmini Sultans, there was peace for a number of years. And during 1500 AD, Quali Qutub ul Malik declared independence from Bahminis. As we already saw, this Quali Qutub ul Malik is the founder of Quali Qutub Shah dynasty and he built the Hyderabad city. See, under his rule, the dynasty operated from a fort built by the Kakatiya called Golconda. See, the region prospered under the Qutub Shahi dynasty and it became popular as hub of diamond and pearl trading. Apart from this, the dynasty has a glorious part for their architecture also. Some of the examples of Qutub Shahi Indo-Islamic architecture are the Golconda Fort, tombs of Qutub Shahis, Char Minar and the Char Kaman. The dynasty came to an end when the Aurangzeb, the Mughal emperor of Delhi, invaded the dynasty. So the Qutub Shahi was defeated by Aurangzeb and the dynasty came to an end. So with these informations, let us move on to the next segment of the discussion. Now, let us take up these images for our next discussion. These images are taken from the Nagarhole National Park during a jungle safari ride. Here we can see a pack of wild dogs and a pair of spotted deer. So in this backdrop, let us know about the Nagarhole National Park from the preliminary perspective. Let us start our discussion by knowing about the history of the origin of Nagarhole as a national park. The origin of the reserve as a protected area is dated back to the regime of the Udaya dynasty. Know that the Udaya dynasty were the former rulers of the kingdom of Mysore. Initially, Nagarhole was an exclusive hunting reserve of the kings, and by 1955, it was set up as a wildlife sanctuary by Coorg state. It was upgraded to a national park in 1988, and by 1999, it was declared as a tiger reserve. By declaring it as a tiger reserve, it was brought under the fold of the Project Tiger. And by this upgradation, the Nagarhole National Park became the 37th tiger reserve of India. This national park is a part of the Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve as well. It is also a UNESCO World Heritage Site. So, this is very unique fact about Nagaholi National Park. That it serves as a national park, a tiger reserve, and it is a part of Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve, and it is also a World Heritage Site. See, the Nagaholi National Park is situated in the Mysore and Kodagu districts of the Karnataka state. The Nagaholi River flows in the center of the park and it joins the Kabini River. Note that the Kabini River is the tributary of River Kaveri. Nagaholi National Park is located northwest of the Bandipo National Park, and the Kabini Reservoir separate these two national parks. Geographically, forests of Nagaholi are primarily deciduous. It has excellent moist deciduous forest, including high quality teak bearing areas. See, deciduous forest are nothing but it is a variety of forest which is dominated by trees that lose their leaves each year during the beginning of dry season. The wild animals present in the park includes tiger, panther, wild dog, elephant, bison, spotted deer, barking deer, sloth bear, wild boar, and varieties of reptiles and birds. See, the Nagaholi National Park is inhabited by the Jenu Kuruba tribe. In Kannada language, Jenu means honey and Kuruba means shepherd. The Jenu Kuruba tribe demonstrate a strong emotional attachment to the forest as their mother deity. Their food, dress, worship, house, medicine, furniture, etc. are all linked with the forest. So, with this information, we came to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the origin of Nagaholi as a national park, its location, its geography, and its major flora and fauna. With this information, let us move on to the next segment. Now, let us see some of the prelims practice questions. The first question is about Advaita. The question wants us to find the correct statement given below. The first statement states that Shankaracharya was a proponent of Advaita, and the second statement states that it is also called as dualism. The third statement states that it believes that everything is one. Which of the statements given above is or are correct? So, from our discussion, it is clear that statement 1 is correct because Shankaracharya was a proponent of Advaita. And the third statement is also correct because we saw in the discussion that it believes that everything is one. But the second statement is wrong because it is also called as non-dualism. It is not called as dualism, but it is called as non-dualism. So, the correct answer for the question is option B, 1 and 3 only. The second question is about the Nagaholi National Park, and it is a two-statement question. The first statement states that Nagaholi National Park has a sizable amount of irulas, and the second statement states that it is a part of Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve. Which of the following statement given above is or are correct? So, from our discussion, we know that Jenu Kuruba tribes are the inhabitants of Nagaholi National Park, not the irulas. So, actually, irulas are a particularly vulnerable tribal group in northern Tamil Nadu and Kerala. They have expert understanding about snakes, due to which recently some members of the tribe were called to Florida to deal with the python problem there. So, the correct answer for the question is option B, 2 only. The main questions are displayed here. Please write answer and post it on the comment section. With this, we came to the end of the discussion. If you like the video, please like, comment and share. And please do subscribe to the Shankar IAS Academy's YouTube channel. Thank you.